The Rush Limbaugh Show, and my pleasure to welcome Mr. Larry Elder. And, sir, I have been a fan of yours for a long time. I've read just about everything you've written. I saw Uncle Tom the day it came out online, and I loved it. Welcome to the show.
Ken, thank you so much for having me. The film is exceeding my expectations. You know, you do something and you have a likely case scenario, maybe really good case scenario, and spectacularly good case scenario. It's exceeded that. It's been amazing.
It is a wonderful American film that happens to showcase so many wonderful people in the African American community. It's a double bonus, and I've said this before. I said it the day I saw it. People should be viewing this now. This is a film that needs to be seen today, and it would change what's happening in our culture.
I think it would. I think it really would. The film is called Uncle Tom, and you can see it, of course, on UncleTom.com, and it's about the grief that black conservatives like Candace Owens and people who are not known, like the sort of the heart and soul of the film, a guy named Chad Jackson, who is a contractor in Dallas. And Ken, he's a lifelong Democrat, a Christian, and he made some critical comments one time to a fellow Christian about Republicans, and that fellow Christian challenged him to read the party platforms of the Democratic Party and Republican Party platform. He'd never done it. After he did it, he said, "I'm a Republican," and it's about the grief that he got from friends and family simply for suggesting that maybe, just maybe, we ought to rethink our allegiance to the Democratic Party. After all, this is a party that does not care about borders, and there are studies that show unskilled illegal aliens compete for jobs that would otherwise be held by unskilled black and brown workers. We've seen all the bad public schools, and one party, the Republican Party, wants to give you an option out. Maybe we ought to be talking to the party that wants to give us the option away from an underperforming public school. You got 13 public high schools in Baltimore where 0% of kids can do math at grade level. Now, you're living within a certain geographical radius of one of those schools. You're mandated to go to that school, and Republican Party wants to give you an option out, and we're pulling that lever like lemming for the Democratic Party. Maybe we ought to rethink this. And the point really, Ken, is when people like myself and some of the people in the film, Brandon Tatum and Reverend Stephen Brolin, and Tom Soul, a rapper named Kingface, Bob Woodson, Carol Swain, when we raise these questions, instead of it sparking what you would expect and hope would be a healthy debate within the black community about the best policies to advance the country in general and the best policies to advance the black community in particular, we're called Uncle Toms and coons and things I can't say on family radio. It's ridiculous. And all the movie says is, can we, as Americans, have the ability to be free to think and to, in good faith, reach different opinions without one side being maligned and excluded from the conversation as Uncle Tom's.
And the thing that is so powerful about it, and you mentioned Carol Swain, and I'm a big fan of Professor Swain as well. She's brilliant, and Thomas Sowell is probably one of the most brilliant thinkers ever, especially of our generation. And you yourself, Mr. Elder, have been a role model for millions of conservatives, in particular people of color, that are, they're afraid to push the boundaries of debate because of what you just said. They'll be demonized, ostracized. Where do you think we are? Do you think we're moving in the right direction under a President Trump administration? Do you think that things are going to change once the dust settles from where we are now?
I think they've already changed, Ken. I think that right now, if the vote were held today, Donald Trump would get at least 50, maybe 100% more than he got in 2016, which would be pretty substantial. Look, before the pandemic and our response to it, you're talking about historic low unemployment for black people. This man pardoned Jack Johnson, the first black heavyweight champion. Barack Obama didn't do that. And Jack O. Johnson was railroaded. He was consorting with white women. He allegedly violated what's called the Mann Act, which is a law that forbids you from taking a woman across state lines, quote, for illicit purposes. It was a bogus prosecution, and even Obama didn't pardon him. This man, Donald Trump, has spent more money on historically black colleges. He spent more money on so-called enterprise zones. He's doing something about immigration. I've talked to you earlier about the impact of that. And for crying out loud, he supports choice in school. I went to Crenshaw High School in L.A. That's a high school that was a center of the movie Boys in the Hood. And right now, 3% of kids at my high school can do math at grade level, honestly. And it's a CRIP school, meaning it's run by the a gang called the Crips. I know that because Ice-T later on went to my high school and told me he chose it because he wanted to go to a Crip school. Now, all of the conservatives in this film believe that we ought to be talking about school choice. We're not listened to. Imagine if Walter Williams and Tom Sowell, who've been talking about choice for 30 or 40 years, had been listened to. We might have moved the ball so that we don't have these horrific dropout rates. We don't have schools where even those who do often graduate in the inner city cannot read, write, and compute at grade level, have to have remedial courses in junior college or four-year college.
I think one of the most frustrating things is you mentioned Walter Williams, another brilliant thinker, and it's an injustice that academia and the news media does not share the messages of some of these men and women, because these are American messages. They're not just race at only. They're American messages, but because this is so left-leaning and the Democrats need certain groups to behave a certain way, I think so often messages like your own get shortchanged. Like, your book should be required reading in high school.
Well, David Mamet, the playwright, said that Thomas Sowell, he credits Thomas Sowell with helping him change from, quote, being a brain-dead liberal, that's his phrase, not mine, and calls Thomas Sowell America's greatest contemporary philosopher. And a lot of people, especially black people, have no idea who he is. Probably the most important magazine for decades, no longer as significant, was Ebony Magazine. Every black home had a copy of that on the coffee table. And every year they had a feature called the 100 Most Influential Black Americans. And every year, absent from that list, were Thomas Sowell, never mind, he's published about 57 some odd books, and Walter Williams, who to my knowledge is the only black man ever to head the economics department of a non-black college or university. Yet many black people have no idea who they are because the black media completely ignores them.
And you look at the way Ben Carson was treated, Herman Cain is treated, and it's just, what is the solution to this? I mean, how do we get more people to
Yeah, people have to wake up, and as you know, the movie talks a lot about the history of the Republican Party and the history of the Democratic Party, and many people don't even realize Democrats opposed the 13th Amendment, the 14th Amendment, the 15th Amendment. Democrats founded the KKK. As a percentage of the party, more Republicans voted for the Civil Rights Act of 1964 than Democrats, and the Democrats respond by saying there was this big switch in the mid-60s, you know, like Peyton Manning saying, Omaha, and all of a sudden all the racist, all the racist Democrats join the Republican Party. The problem with that theory is if you look at all the Democrats who voted against the Civil Rights Act in the Senate and the House and ask yourself how many of them switched to Republicans, one in the Senate, one in the House. And the first Republican to be elected from to the Senate in Tennessee since Reconstruction was a Republican named Howard Baker, who was pro-integration. It is a lie that all of a sudden all the racists left the Democratic Party in the 60s and joined the Republican Party. It's a lie that the Democrats have been pushing, and we deal with that in the movie Uncle Tom.
And you see it with, Candace Owens is a good example of a millennial conservative success story, a very articulate, energetic conservative. I had the pleasure of speaking with her in Philadelphia. And you were talking about something when you were talking about the positive things that President Trump is doing for communities of color in all of America. I had the honor to interview in person in Washington, D.C., the niece of Martin Luther King Jr., which was just, I was sitting right across from history, Alveda King. And the things she was saying were exactly what you are saying. Why aren't people on the left and leftist leaders, especially leaders of color in the Democrat Party, embracing these American foundational principles that you and your colleagues have embraced?
Because the Democratic Party has convinced black people that they are under siege, that they're perpetual victims. And by the way, these guys over here, these guys in the dark trench coats, they're called Republicans, and they're racist. And so black people are not thinking about the quality of schools. Black people are not thinking about the crime in their own neighborhoods. They're not thinking about the impact of the economy because of porous borders. They're thinking about racism, 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 when in fact Obama's election and reelection should have put the fork in the notion that racism is a big enough impediment to stop anybody who's talented and willing to work hard. My God, this man came from nowhere, had a name nobody could pronounce, middle name Hussein from Hawaii. He takes down Hillary. He takes down John McCain. He takes down Mitt Romney for reelection. And with By the way, he got elected with 52% of the vote, but by the time he walked into the White House, his numbers were almost at 70%. How does that happen? Because so many Americans thought the guy that they were voting for was the guy who was on Steve Croft on 60 Minutes before he got elected, when Croft said to him, "Senator, if you don't win this race, will it be because of racism?" And I sat back in and I said, let's see how this man answers this question. Let's see if he gets a Jesse Jackson or an Al Sharpton type answer or what. And he said, no. If I don't win, it will be because I failed to articulate a vision that the American people can embrace. And I said, hallelujah. But he got in. What happened? The Cambridge police acted stupidly. If I had a son, he'd look like Trayvon. Oh, my goodness, we've got problems, too. It's called Ferguson. He invites Al Sharpton to the White House a bunch of times. He hires Eric Holder, who lectures us about race and racism, and says things like, when it comes to race, America has been a nation of cowards. All because the politician Obama knows, Ken, he's got to make black people angry to get that 95% black vote. But you think he's telling Sasha and Malia that racism is going to hold them back? You think he's really doing that? No way. This man thought of himself as a world beater. That's why he ran for president, and that's why he got elected. He knows it's nonsense. And I wonder sometimes, Ken, honestly, how this man sleeps at night peddling this poison to his people while knowing full well that his success shows you what you can do in America if you try.
It is. That is, and what a great thing to wrap up on, because that is a great American success story. And one thing that, and you pointed it out brilliantly, President Barack Obama played the race card. He just did it very eloquently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he did it in speeches.
Every bit as dastardly as Al Sharpton, but far more eloquently, which makes him far more dangerous.
Yes. So the website is UncleTom.com. Any other advice so how we can get more people to see this movie? I don't know if you heard, but I bought DVDs for my sons after I saw it online.
No, yeah. Don't just go to the website and tell your friends. But more than that, tell independents and liberals. They're the ones who need to see this film. Ken, you didn't learn anything new, but a lot of people will.
Well, thank you so much. Keep up the good fight. Larry Elder, God bless you, and thanks for calling in, sir.
God bless you. Thank you so much for having me.